Tony's a successful businessman, lifeguard, race car driver, and a champion. He's an Olympic gold medalist in the shot put, discus, and the javelin. A qualified pilot, creating New Zealand history. He's a second degree black belt in Taekwondo, so don't mess with him because he will hurt you. Can we please put your hands together? Please be on your feet. Give him an amazing Gold Coast welcome, Mr. Tony Christensen.
A lot of you are sitting down in the back going, where the hell is he? I can see you. And obviously I'm sitting here in my wheelchair, and what Eric didn't tell you is that I don't have any legs. And when he said I was excited to be here, I am actually excited to be here, and I'm excited to see all these people in the room. I spoke at a conference in the US not that long ago, and they said, Tony, you're in Hall 3 at 2 p.m. So I Hall 3, 2 p.m., out onto the stage, and like there's one guy sitting in the front row, one guy in the seat. And I'm thinking, it's 2 o'clock and it's Hall 3? Okay, maybe this is it. So I look at this guy and I said, sir, thank you so much for being here. Really looking forward to having the next hour together to share with you my story, and I'm sure that we will interact together. And he looked at me and he said, can you hurry up because I'm the janitor and I want to close the doors. So when I say I'm really glad that you're here, I really mean it. And it's really interesting, when I was asked to be here, you get to know Joel and their sense of humour, and I struggle with it at times, to be honest, because they have different rooms, and a lot of rooms, nice big stages and things like that. I came into the room yesterday afternoon when you're out, and I looked at the stage and I said to Joel, I'm going to be in my chair and I don't know if everybody's going to see me on the stage. Can you raise it up for me a little bit higher? And look what he's gone and done. Stuck a bloody trestle up. Good on you, mate. I can do this. I'll just jump out of my chair. I'll pull my chair up so we can sort of get a hang of this thing. God, the things you got to do. And I sort of got up here and I'm thinking, hey, this is cool. Yeah, I can. Look at the thing. Safety and health approved. And so I climbed up it early this morning when I saw it, and I lost my pants. So you guys might get more than what you bargained for sitting in the front table. I don't know, I've got to say. But here we go. Oh, man. Oh, Aaron, lost my footing. Much better. It's great, I feel like Humpty Dumpty sitting up here. We all know what happened to him, don't we? As I say, it is a great pleasure for me to be here with you today at this four-day seminar. And what I'm going to do for just our very short time together is share with you some of my story. You see, I believe that we all have a story in our lives. What do you think the first question is that people ask me when they meet me? Anyone? How did you lose your legs? In fact, that's the second question that people ask, because I know most ladies are thinking, aren't you Brad Pitt? Well, it could be just a shorter version. The second question that people ask is, how did you lose your legs? And when I'm sitting on the local surf beach, I call out, shark. Man, did that clear the water quick. What I can tell you today is that I was run over by a train when I was 9 years old. You know, I can remember that day like it was yesterday. I can remember pleading with my mum to let me go with my good friend Gary and his dad to the local railway yards where they were bagging coal for community project. You know, I can still remember the reluctance of my mum's voice when she let me go. I remember walking across the tracks with Gary to get some more sacks to be filled. And as we walked back, the two 40-ton wagons shunted backwards and was dragged underneath. The next thing I can remember is looking up. Gary's father was leaning over me. He was screaming and crying. I remember going in the ambulance to the local hospital. Mum and Dad were at the emergency room doors, and I looked up and I said, "I'm sorry, Mum, but I'll be okay." I woke up 6 days later in intensive care. Mum and Dad were sitting at the end of the bed, and I had this really terrible itch in my foot, and I went to scratch it. And that was when they told me that those feet weren't there anymore. Believe me, I can remember that day like it was yesterday. During the time that I was in the hospital, two good friends of my parents, Dave Franklin and Alan Guthrie, were swimming coaches, and they'd read an article at teaching disabled people to swim as a great form of therapy. So I'd come in this category of life being disabled, and I'm sitting on the edge of the pool one sunny afternoon, like they always are in New Zealand, and I'm thinking to myself, well, this is great. I hate water. I can't swim. I haven't got any legs. How's this going to happen? You know, you teach a dog to swim. You pick it up, you throw it in the water, and it either sinks or swims, right? They picked me up, they threw me, and I sank. And I'm sitting on the bottom of the pool looking up, and they got the big net. You know, the one they used to scoop the leaves out. Got the net, scooped me out of the pool, sat me on the side and said, "Look, Tony, it's not going to look good on our resume if you drown. We're going to teach you to swim." I remember one length becoming two lengths becoming three. Dave Franklin walked every one of them with me after 5 months. I swam a mile, which was 52 lengths of that pool nonstop, and I was only just 10 years old. For me, that was my first taste of goal setting, what I could achieve with the right attitude, accepting the challenge that life had thrown us. I remember going through what we have in New Zealand, intermediate and boys' college. At the end of the fifth form year, at the age of 15, they had options. Now, these options were we could go away on a camp for a week. We could go and play golf, rugby, soccer, camping and tramping. I sat down and I thought, well, geez, I don't have a lot of options, don't we? Really, do I? Went on a surf life-saving camp, which again was run by Dave Franklin. At the end of the week-long course, I achieved my surf bronze medallion, joining the local surf life-saving club. Beautiful sunny Saturday afternoon, like they always are in New Zealand. My good friend Warren and I, we were the two lifeguards on duty. We were called to a rescue about 4 kilometres from the surf club. So I'm sitting in this hand on my backside, up into the Jeep I climb. Warren drove us off. He pulled the Jeep up close to the short break. We jumped out, put the rescue tubes around ourselves, and there were three young people caught in a rip. Two boys about 200 metres offshore. Warren swam out to the boys, and there was a girl of about 17 or 18 years old. Obviously, I went and got the girl. When I got to her, she was in a great amount of distress, really upset. Calming her down, I assured her that I knew exactly what I was doing. Everything would be just fine. I put the rescue tube around her, and we slowly swam back into the beach. And, you know, I'd say with our conversation, she had this image of a 6'2" bronze lifeguard. Because we're in the short break, the water was up to here on me, and I had my arm over her. She was still floating, and I'm sort of dragging along the sand. We got to the point where she could stand up. Because she stood up, looked down at me, looked out at the surf, looked back down at me, and fainted. And I gained a reputation of causing more accidents than I saved. For me, it was a very special time in my life. You know, I suppose it was one of those acceptance things because that's what all my friends were doing. And that time, my life, 15, 16 years old, sitting in front of television with my mum and dad. The Olympic Games were on. Now, we've all seen the Olympic Games, the medal presentations. And like many of you, I thought to myself, wouldn't it be an awesome experience to represent your country? Can you imagine what it's like to be up on a podium, receive a medal, have your national anthems played, that proud moment it must be? I remember the high jump was on at the time. I wasn't too sure I was going to do that one. But a bit later that year, I was introduced to the disabled sport movement. When away to the Nationals in Wellington, was selected to go to Japan. And as was said, I've been overseas 6 times to the World and Paralympic Games. Many gold, silver and bronze medals. A story I'd like to share with you this morning, which is dear to my heart, was at the 1980 Paralympics in Arnhem, Holland, the final of the 100 metres backstroke. We're all in the pool, getting ready to start. We looked to the side and they were lifting this young man from Israel out of his wheelchair and putting him into the water. He had spina bifida. He had these little wee short twisted up arms. Very small body, little legs, floating away on his back. We started the race and I finished second in a time of 1 minute 15 seconds. We got out of the pool, we were drying ourselves down. We looked back and there was this little guy still going. His little wee arms were flipping away. Every now and again he sang under the water. He came back up, he went out. You know, it took him 9 minutes to finish the event. On that day, we were up on the podium, receiving our medals, having an Ashland Anthems played, that proud moment that I'd always imagined. You know, it was a prouder moment when we took our medals off and we offered them to that young man. You see, we felt that his achievement was greater than ours. We won the race. That's what we trained for. You know what? He finished. What that's allowed me to do in my life is to appreciate. Is to appreciate the things that I have. You see, I know many, many disabled people that are far worse off than I am. Yet in saying that, I know many able-bodied people are far more disabled than I'll ever be. Why? Because of their attitudes. Their attitudes to their lives, to their families, to their friends, to their work, to their customers. What are attitudes? I believe attitudes are habits of thought, the way we think about things. If our habits of thought are unenthusiastic with a lack of desire, it's reflected in our attitude. If our habits of thought are enthusiastic with a desire to succeed, accept the challenges that life throws at us, that's reflected in our attitude. And I believe in my heart that it's our attitudes which determine our level of success in life. You see, we ought to be successful, don't we?
Yep.
I think I'll do that one again. You see, we ought to be successful, don't we?
Yes!
Anybody in the room today that doesn't? All right, I was going to say you're probably in the wrong room. It's all about an attitude, really, isn't it? But what is success? For you to be successful in your life, and I know you're doing your vision boards earlier today, what do you believe success is? Just call it out, share it with me and the others in the room. What do you believe success is?
Achieve a goal.
Achieving goals?
Fulfillment.
Fulfillment?
Live your dream.
Live your dream? More time?
Development.
Development?
Freedom.
Freedom?
Happiness.
Choice? Happiness? Standing up for what you believe in?
Contributing.
That's 11 now. Hey, I've got a long, long day. I can see that coming. I don't have to leave till 3. Yeah, I bet you could. Look, success is something different to each and every one of us. To some it is health, wealth, security, respect, happiness, family. Being successful in my life is to achieve the goals that are set for myself. That's something I want to share with you today is that I'm a goal setter. I'm a planner. In fact, I'm going to ask another question. How many fellow goal setters here today in your business and your personal lives? How many set goals? Excellent. A few hands. Great. Something else I want to share with you is I'm a dreamer. How many fellow dreamers? Well, there's a few more of them. Well, I tell you what. Sitting up here, I see each and every one of you. I see each and every one of your faces. I ask a question. Most of you put your hand up. It's like this. Here's another one. Can you remember the first day you went to school 5 years old?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm looking around a few of you probably can't. 5 years old, the teacher would ask the class a question. Before they'd finished asking, what do we do? Yes, stuck your hand up. Didn't know the answer. We didn't even know the bloody question. They're going to ask it, me. What changes in our lives for us to stop putting our hands up? Have we been told that we're wrong too many times? I read an article several years ago now, and it said that the average 17-year-old in both New Zealand and Australia had been told the words no or can't 148,000 times. The challenge we face is, if we hear it enough times, we actually start to believe it, or are we too busy worrying about what other people think of us? Oh, you're not one of those goal setters, are you? You're not a planner, are you? You don't want to be successful, do you? I'm here today to tell you the successful people, whatever they choose in life, are goal setters. They are planners. They have their plan for today, tomorrow, next week, next month, next year, the next 5 or 10 years of their lives. You see, I actually believe life's like driving a car. If you don't steer it, you end up going somewhere you don't want to be. So I'm going to ask again, how many fellow planners? Excellent. How many fellow dreamers? All right. How many procrastinators? Get your hands up. I'll tell you what, there's a lot of you out there. Look, in my life, I'm inspired. In my life, I'm inspired by achievements I've seen of people far worse off than I am. I've seen Olympic blind runners, do the 100 meters fractions of a second slower than a world able-bodied record. I have seen Olympic high jumpers with one leg jumping centimeters less than the world able-bodied record. In fact, have you ever seen blind soccer players? Anybody? Blind soccer? No? Unbelievable. True. They get a ball. They fill it full of bells. They throw it in the middle of the paddock and off they go kicking it around. They got two different sounding horns at each end. And they go to the end. Unbelievable to see. I was at the 1988 Paralympics in Seoul, Korea. My friend Bruce was the coach of New Zealand blind soccer team. Finished all of my events. Bruce said, look, Tony, I'm taking the guys to the park for a training session for their game tomorrow. Do you want to come? I said, yeah, that'd be great. So we're in the van, down to the park. He opened up the door, got the guys out, picked up the ball, threw it in the middle of the paddock, and off they went kicking around. Unbelievable. I said, what do you do now? He said, well, I just wait. I said, how long does it take? He said, oh, about half an hour. They don't even know I'm here. Well, look, all good Kiwis. I spotted a bar across the road. I said, mate, we might as well go and sit in the bar. We were in there 10 minutes. Someone came running in and said, who's looking after those blind soccer players across the road? We said, oh, we are. They said, you better go and get them. They've lost their ball. They're kicking the crap out of a Hare Krishna. He said, ching, ching. Yeah, it's probably one of those you had to be there things, I suppose, really. At the age of 17 years old, my mum came to me and said, Tony, you've got to go and get a job. Now, you all know at 17 years old, who wants to get a job? You see, I thought I didn't have any legs. So I wondered what I could do. And then I thought, hey, I don't have any legs. Nobody's going to blame me for not doing anything. But, you know, there was someone. And it was me, because I did think, what could I do? My friends were out riding push bikes, climbing trees, doing all of the things that young people did. I spent a lot of time at home. So I started to do drawings and cartoons, graphic art. And then I started to do show cards and posters for local stores and supermarkets. It got to the point my friends would be earning $10 a week doing a paper round. I could earn like $50, $80, $100 a week doing these show cards and posters. So me being the bright young guy that I was, I thought, oh, I can make money at this. I want to be a signwriter. That's what I want to be, a signwriter. So I went around all of the signwriting companies in the city of Tauranga where I live, and I said, hey guys, I can do this signwriting thing. How about a job? They looked at me and said, you don't have any legs. I thought it was pretty clever of them, really, wasn't it? not much got past them. I said, yeah, but I can do this signwriting thing. How about a job? They said, well, you haven't got any legs. You can't climb ladders. You can't climb trestles. You can't drive the truck, so you're no good to us. My story is I pestered one guy long enough. He gave me an opportunity. At the end of 3 months, he made me foreman. Right through to today, where I owned that company for 13 years, turned into one of the most successful signwriting companies in New Zealand, and in fact, in Australasia. When I took it over, I had a staff of two, turnover less than $90,000 a year. I sold it in December 1998 as a multi-million dollar company. You see, for me, that's my measure of success. But believe me, success is a journey, something we strive and achieve every day of our lives. I tell you what, if I had a dollar for every time I was told I couldn't do something, I'd be a billionaire today. I believe when we're born, we don't know can't, wouldn't, shouldn't, couldn't, get real, and don't waste your time. We're taught all of those things by other people. It's up to us to decide whether we believe that or not. My art teacher said to me once, Christensen, you're absolutely hopeless. You'll never have anything to do with art in your life. I wished I could have employed her, just so I could fire her. And one of the great things I enjoyed about sign writing is we'd be on trestles just like this. We'd be twice, three times the height of this. There'd be three of us up here. We'd be sign writing the face of a building, but only two pairs of legs hanging over the side. People go, how the hell do you do that? They used to ask me to climb down just so they could see how I got back up again. One of the challenges I face in my life today, look, I think it's a challenge that we all face in one way or another. That's the challenge of people's perceptions. Other people's perceptions of who we are and what we believe. You see, we're in a world where we judge people. We're in a world where we put people in boxes. Because I get, oh, you're one of those disabled people, so we'll stick you in a box over there. Oh, even, hey, you're with the 21st century group, so we'll put you in a box over there. Oh, you know, we've got the GFC at the moment, haven't we? So we'll put that in a little box over there. We're in a world where we judge people. rather than allow ourselves to go out, share our passion, our belief, and simply be the best. This thing about people's perception. My friends and I, we go out for dinner. The waiter goes up to them and said, "Would you like a drink?" It's like, "Hello." So I don't know, ask him. When they do, I go, "Aah!" I'm sitting in a chair. People come up and go, "How you doing? All right?" So look, I haven't got any legs. I'm not deaf. But that's people's perception. In fact, in my business life, I would go out to quote the sign writing of a 20-meter wall. I'd jump out of the back of my van into my chair, go up to the client. The look on their face, "Oh, geez, he hasn't got any legs. I wonder if I should tell him." People's perception. Guys, have you heard of the 90-second rule? How many here have heard of the 90-second rule in life? Anybody? No? The 90-second rule? I actually asked this question a little while ago, and this lady said, "Isn't that the amount of time it takes so you can pick food up off the floor?" I said, "No, darling, that's 3 seconds. Oh, 90 seconds. I don't think so. The 90-second rule of life is that you have 90 seconds to make a first impression. Because that is the only impression you will ever leave. You see, you never get a second chance at a first impression. The challenge I face in my life, especially my business life, I had 30 seconds. I had 30 seconds to convince those clients that choosing me and my company was the best option that they could take. You see, it is all about an attitude. It's about a desire. It's about a belief. It's about that simple belief that success will come to me. Motorsport's a great passion of mine. My good friend Ewan Cameron and I, we race an off-road racing truck together. This truck's four-wheel drive, 600 horsepower, capable of over 130 miles an hour. Ewan's the driver, I'm the co-driver navigator. We were leading the Woodhill 100 off-road race, one of New Zealand's premier off-road events. At over 120 miles an hour along the Mutawai beachfront, the truck hit a rut in the sand and it end-over-ended 3 times. Finishing upside down, we'd ruptured the fuel tank, fuel and all pouring out of the back of the truck. I looked across at Ewan and I said, "Mate, are you all right?" He said, "Yeah, I'm okay." I said, "This is not good. We better get out of here." Oh, something I've got to tell you about Ewan is that he has an artificial leg. So the joke is we've only got one good leg between the two of us. The truck's upside down, the fuel's pouring out. Without even thinking about it, undid my seatbelt, landed straight on my head. I think that's why I've got this squashed up fat neck now. But anyway, Ewan got his artificial leg jammed between the accelerator and the brake pedal. So I sort of shuffled around in the sand. I undid his artificial leg for him. Ewan put his hand on the roof, undid his belt, slid out of the truck. And he's hopping away on one leg, trying to keep his balance, leaning against the truck. I'm sitting in the sand, rubbing my neck. And the story goes that another competitor saw the accident. Went back to the pit area, said to the officials, "You'd better get an ambulance down on the beachfront. There's a horrific accident down there." Now, they looked at him quite puzzled because we were going to be the first car through. He said, "No, I'm serious. One guy's got his leg cut off, the other guy's buried up to his waist in sand." When the officials heard that, they thought, "Oh, not those clowns again." In fact, I can't remember anybody even coming to get us that day. You see, for me, that's what my life's like. It's a lot of fun. I believe that if you don't enjoy it, don't do it. I believe that we're on this earth for a good time, not always a long time. What I'd like to do now, if I can, is share with you just some of the things I enjoy doing in my life. I've got several pieces of video that I'm going to share with you this morning. The first piece of video, you'll see skydiving, 7 skydives now, 3 tandem and 4 solo skydives landed in Lake Taupo. You will see cars racing. See if you can work out which cars I'm driving. The New Zealand wheelchair basketball team played for the team for 8 years, representing New Zealand, and also some of New Zealand's spectacular scenery. So please watch the screen.
Hard to stand. You want to end up winning? Well, it's time to make your plan. time to act. It's time to break the shackles. It's time to attack. Reach for the sky. Reach for the sky. Reach for the sky. And let's fly. Storm clouds circling, and there's nowhere left to run. It's the speed of others hurtling. You know your journey has begun. If the distance is your vision, you don't ever want to lose. Make the right decision. It's yours to choose. Reach for the sky. Reach for the sky. Reach for the sky. Let's fly. With bounded expectations, it's time to break the chains. Just pick the destination. To wash away the stains. Some men are grounded, and I don't even know why. Don't say how far, say how high. Reach for the sky. 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 Reach for the sky.
One of my good friends saw that piece of video for the first time several months ago. And he looked at it and he said, Tony G, you crash a lot. I got some really good friends, I tell you. In fact, he calls me Toenails, is my nickname. And I haven't got any. He saw that piece of video and he said, gee, Tony, you crash a lot. And I thought about an answer because I needed to have a really good answer for that one. And I actually thought that it's a really good analogy of life, motorsport. Especially speedway, the one that you race on the dirt oval tracks and you've got a concrete wall on the outside, track's about 20 metres wide. If I follow the person in front of me, where am I going to finish the race? Second. I'm always going to be behind, aren't I? You see, but in my life, I'm a leader. I'm not a follower. And leaders take risks. So to pass the guy in front of me, I have to take a risk. I have to pull outside and pass him. And that brings me closer to that concrete wall. And I do crash a lot. I've been racing for over 30 years. The law of averages tell me that I will crash. But you know what? I win a lot of races as well. And I think it's a really good analogy of life, because if you're a follower, that's fine. I'm not here to judge you, but I'm not. I'm a leader. And I will take the risk to achieve my goals because I am a leader, not a follower. And that's a choice. You also saw at the end of that video the whitewater rafting. And in that piece of video, you saw a young man from South Korea. His name is Kim Yoon. Kim came to New Zealand about 7 or 8 years ago now. He was one of South Korea's most promising young male actors in New Zealand to film a documentary. While there, he was involved in a horrific car accident, which left him a quadriplegic. Later that year, when I met him, we took him out tandem skydiving, pushed him out on an airplane, whitewater rafting, jet boat racing. And that was another documentary that was filmed and shown on Korean television about 6 months later. Those are Lin sets. Were Kim's parents, as they hadn't seen him since he'd left over a year beforehand. You see, for people like Kim, life will never ever be the same. I could be here today and tell you that life's not fair. Life's not always fair. Because I said, why me? Why me? Why did this have happened to me? I was 9 years old. Why could it have been anybody else but me? And I think the answer really is, why not me? You see, for me, the reality of my life is it's not what happens to you, it's what you do about it that makes a difference. The reality of my life is that I'm 53 years old. I'm just over halfway through my life. I've still got the best half yet to come. I haven't got time to be disappointed. I haven't got time to regret. And I don't have time to blame other people. I only have time to go out, create, and accept the challenges of life and simply be the best. You know, that's all I know, my mum and dad, my brother, my sister, my family, my friends, my workmates, my customers ever asked of me, is be the best. I also know as a goal setter that this world will only give me exactly what I ask for, nothing more, nothing less. People come to me and they say, Tony, you're so lucky. You're so lucky you got run over by a train and lost your legs. Alrighty. Well, they tell us that adversity makes us a better person, don't they? You've all heard that? You've all heard that a challenge in your life is going to make you dig down deep inside and bring out the best in us. We've all heard that one, haven't we? My question is, why do we wait? Why are most people sitting around their lives waiting for something to happen? Waiting for something bad to happen before they go out, accept the challenges, create those challenges, and simply be the best. Look, before this accident, I could have done 10,000 things with my life. I could have been a world-class downhill skier. I could have been an Olympic cyclist. I could have been a brain surgeon. I could have been an airline pilot. Since this accident, I can do 8,000 things with my life. I have the choice. I can sit around and dwell, think about the 2,000 things I'm never going to do, or simply go out and do the 500, which are going to make my life great. You see, there's no point in me saying I wanted to be one of the Wallabies, one of the rugby players. Although the way you play it, Tom, I'd probably have a pretty good chance, wouldn't I, really? Go the Kiwis. Yeah. Hey, it's my plank, all right? Yeah. Just say what I like. We're in a world where we're told if you're not a winner, you're a loser. And if you're not a success, you're a failure. What happened to Aussie in the World Cup, right? Hey, Monday morning newspapers. Losers! What do they want to do? Sack the coach. The fact that he's a Kiwi's got nothing to do with it, I suppose. You know, we're in a world where we want to blame other people for the challenges rather than accept responsibility, simply be the best. This thing about winning or losing. I entered a weightlifting competition in the Tauranga, the city I live, about 14 years ago now. It was an able-bodied weightlifting competition. I entered the bench press. I won the event with a lift of 220 kilos. The officials came up to me afterwards and said, Tony, awesome lift, well done, you've been disqualified. I asked them why. They said that one of the other competitors had brought it to their attention that Rule 16(2) clearly states that all competitors must wear the appropriate footwear. Wouldn't you believe it? The day I go new well, I forget to take my shoes. That is a true story. True story. Look, guys, I believe that the greatest challenge we face in life today is communication. Simple communication. Look, for me to be here today to share my story, but as I said, each and every one of you would have an extraordinary story. For you to take the time out of your busy lives to come away to this four-day seminar. It is all about communication. And communication comes in so many different ways. And I'll give you a few examples. Actually, guys, I'm looking around. Has your wife ever said to you not communicating? Any of you ever got that? Hey? Come on, be honest. Good on you. Few honest guys at least. I got that. My wife said to me, Tony, we're not communicating. Most of the time I think, you don't listen to me. Well, I used to think that's what she said. All those years ago when I had this accident, gosh, we're talking 42 years ago now, there was no such thing as ACC, accident compensation. The old social welfare system. You have workers' comp here in Australia. When ACC first came out, accident compensation, they had like a schedule. And it was lump sum day. So if you had an accident, they gave you a lump sum. And they had a schedule and they said, if you lost an eye, we'll give you $10,000. If you lose an arm, we'll give you $15,000. If you lose a leg, we'll give you $25,000. My parents and I, we would have got $50,000. But no, the old social welfare system. Even today, I have a social welfare number. They call it WINS, Work and Income New Zealand. I got a letter from WINS several years ago. Talk about communication from the government. It read, "Dear Mr. Christensen, we noted a review of your files. You are a double amputee. Do you expect your condition to improve within the next 12 months? here's another one. Now, insurance company. Anybody here today involved in insurance? Anybody here? Hey, I wouldn't admit to it either, would you? Bloody insurance companies drive you nuts. I had to have a new life insurance policy in February this year. So what do? You go to the doctor, right? Blood test, blood pressure, the whole deal. Doctor said, Tony, sit on the scales. I sat on the scales. He went over to his desk. He brought out a chart. It's the height to weight ratio chart. He's looking at this chart. He said, Tony, at 1 meter high, you should weigh 19 kilos. Yeah, right, my arm weighs 90 kilos. Here's another. Oh, look, when things go wrong in our business lives, who do we blame? Because we've got to blame somebody in our business life. Who do we blame? Anybody here? No? Staff? No? Customers? No? Who do we blame when things go wrong in our business lives? Anybody? Everybody else? The government. We do. We blame the government. New Zealand, we've just had elections last week. Opportunity to change the government. A little bit of a change. But you see, guys, there's nothing more constant in life than change. And governments change the rules. And that's why we blame them. They blame, they change legislation, they change tax rates. There's nothing more constant in life than change. It's what you do about it that makes the difference. So in our businesses, we blame the government when things go wrong. Now, we have a legislation in New Zealand, and it will come to Australia. How many employers here? How many employers employ staff? Right, a few of you. Supervisors? Managers? Right? Okay, there's a few of you here. Great. Right? Obviously, a few employees here. Now, we have a legislation in New Zealand, been there for about 7 or 8 years now from the Labor government, and it will come to Australia. We gave you GST, didn't we? This legislation will come to Australia, and what it says is that as a manager or an employer of staff, you can be fined $500,000 for causing staff mental stress. That is the legislation in New Zealand, will come to Australia. $500,000 for causing staff mental stress. The maximum fine in New Zealand for vehicular manslaughter is $20,000. It just shows you the mixed communication you get from the government when they tell you that somebody's mental state is worth more than their life. But you see, as an employer, I worked it out that if I had a stressed employee, run them over. Hey? Just back over in the park car park, save yourself $480,000. Hey, all the staff are going, oh, bummer. When I say I'm fortunate to be here, when I said it earlier, look, I mean it from the point of view that all those years ago when I had this accident, many people didn't survive the horrific injuries that I had. Look, we're in a world today where we glue people back together and we call it quality of life. Many people didn't survive those injuries. The doctors came up to my parents. They said, Mr. and Mrs. Christensen, we're so sorry to have to tell you, Tony will either spend the rest of his life in a hospital, in a home. He may not even live past the age of 20 years old. The pressures of life with these horrific injuries would be so great. Obviously, that really upset my mum. I got past the age of 20 years old. They sent me to a psychiatrist. I was in there for 3 hours with that man. It took me that long to straighten him out. Man, did he have some hang-ups. All those years ago, we were called crippled. What a terrible word, crippled. Then we were called disabled and handicapped. Nowadays, we're called physically challenged. In my case, vertically challenged. Actually, my son thought it was great. I'm the only dad that could go to the McDonald's playground because Ronald says you must be this high to enter. I got stuck in that tube thing a while ago. Those buggers were sitting there throwing the balls at me. But anyway, that's another story. I had the opportunity to go to Africa. That opportunity came through KBS Television, Korean Broadcasting Service. They were doing a documentary. The documentary was on myself, a lady named Soo Yong, who was totally blind, and a man named Hong Bin, who'd lost both his hands to frostbite in a climbing accident. During this documentary and expedition, we were to go to Ngorongoro National Park, which is one of the most extraordinary national parks inside a volcanic crater. We were to stay in a Maasai village for 3 days. And then we were to go on to Mount Kilimanjaro, Africa's highest mountain at 5,895 metres high, or 19,500 feet. It is the fifth highest mountain in the world. A little bit of background on Kilimanjaro. 4,000 people attempt to climb it every year. Around 1,400 will make it to the summit. And over 100 people have died of altitude sickness on Kilimanjaro. The climb itself was to take us 13 days. I was to do about 80% of it on my hands and my backside. And we would be climbing between 18 and 19 hours a day. At 5,000 metres at Kibo Hut, it is around minus 15 degrees. And at the summit, at 5,895 metres, it is between minus 25 and minus 35 degrees. During our climb at 5,000 metres, Kibo Hut, Soo Yong and Hong Bin gained altitude sickness, as well as most of the television crew. They had to go back down to Horombo Hut at 3,000 metres to reacclimatise for 4 days. I didn't get altitude sickness. The producer, Jeannie, said that we're all going, and I said, I'm not going, I'm staying. I'm not going back. I'm only going to go to the summit. So I waited for them to come back. Now, at Kibo Hut, as I said, it's minus 15 degrees. There's no food up there. There's no water. There's no heating. All I could do was just wait. I think what I'd like to do now, Daniel, if I can, is share with you the climb of Kilimanjaro. So again, if you please, watch the screens.
Oh, Tony! Tony, so much fun! Nice to
meet you.
Know me, know what's inside your mind, your heart, and see. Close your eyes and make a start. The single seed that we sow, and soon the branches will grow. This is make-believe without the dreaming. You can take my hand and climb to the top. Ride stormy waters and you won't wanna stop. You can chase all your wishes and capture your dreams. You can do anything you want, if you know what I mean.
Okay.
Oh, he's going.
Mama said, learn how to walk before you run. But I felt the wind in my face and the joy of much more fun. The river returns to the sea as the spirit strives to be free. Eyes wide open. So why do you see tomorrow? Well, you can take my hand. Climb to the top. Ride stormy waters and you won't want to stop. You can chase all your wishes and capture your dreams. You can do anything you want if you know what I mean. And there is no need to find, the answer is there inside. If you find you're alone again, understand the words I've said. Well, you can take my hand and climb to the top, ride stormy waters and you won't want to stop. You can chase all your wishes and capture your dreams. You can do anything you want if you know what I mean.
I climbed the Kilimanjaro. You saw where we stayed in that Maasai village there for the 3 days. And that was cow dung that they mix up in those little pots and they smear it over the huts for insulation. The next picture you saw was ugali. Ugali is stiff porridge and they mixed it in the same pot. Yo. You also saw the conditions on Kilimanjaro. A lot of people see that piece of video and they asked me, did I ever want to give up? And the answer is no, giving up was not an option. In fact, giving up was never an option. Not getting to the summit was never an option. I have two plaques on my office wall. One reads, no is not an option. The other one reads, can't is not an option. We are in a world where we accept no and we accept can't. People come to us and say, oh no, you can't do that. We go, oh, okay, I won't do that anymore. It's about believing in yourself and it's about believing in success. It's It's about having an attitude and a desire to succeed. You see, you don't buy it. You don't get up in the morning thinking, oh, geez, I've got to go and do this. And I've got to go, oh, I've got to sort this out. And, oh, not even a really good day. I know what I'll do. I think I'll go to the chemist shop. I'll go and buy a box of motivation. Here's 20 bucks. Oh, the old attitude's not doing very well. I think I'll go and buy another box of attitude. Here's another $20. You don't buy it. Well, it's probably an illegal drug or something like that. I don't know. It's right here. Each and every one of us have it. Our challenge is, how do we bring it out? People call me an extraordinary person. I'm not an extraordinary person. I'm an ordinary person just like you. We are all ordinary people in this world, no matter who they are. Sometimes we choose to do extraordinary things. Each and every one of us in this room today have the same opportunity and the potential for greatness in our lives. We simply have to know what it is to us. People ask me, how do I find the time? How do I find the time to bring up a family, have successful businesses, to travel the world, to race cars, fly airplanes, climb mountains? We've got the same amount of hours in a day as you have. We all have the same amount of hours in our day as, gosh, Thomas Edison, the Wright brothers, Florence Nightingale. It's what you choose to do with those hours that makes the difference. People do come to me and say, Tony, you're so lucky. You're so lucky. You've got the family, you've got the businesses, you travel, you're so lucky. Luck, rubbish. Luck's when you win lotto. But you've got to go and buy a ticket first. I tell you what, those people are sitting there on Saturday night going, geez, they're going to pick those numbers as well. They didn't buy the ticket. Life gives you exactly what you ask for, nothing more, nothing less. One of the other challenges we face is perception. To many, the perception of life is, I can't do that, because they are lucky. No matter how hard I try, oh, I'd never be able to do that. And if that's not good enough, that's just tough. You tell yourself that enough times and you will start to believe it. I believe in success. I believe that good things will come to me. The world will give you exactly what you ask for. Nothing more, nothing less. Be very, very careful what you ask for. Because believe me, it has a really good chance of happening. And you know what? It costs me nothing. I don't have to go to the chemist shop and buy it. It's right here. I'm inspired in my life. I'm inspired in my life by the achievements of so many others. And inspiration comes in so many different ways. Now, how many have seen the movie The World's Fastest Indian? A lot of you here today, look, for those that haven't, please get it out on DVD, The World's Fastest Indian, the story of Bert Munro from Invercargill, New Zealand. At the age of 69 years old, his dream was to go to the Bonneville Salt Flats in the USA. He had a 1929 Indian motorcycle that he used to beach race. At the age of 69 years old, shipped it, went on the ship as the cook, and his road trip to the Bonneville Salt Flats. I saw the movie 27 times. I think it was the only movie that New Zealand had for about a year. Talk about cost cutting. One day I saw that movie and I thought I could do that. So on the 18th of August 2008, I took my drag car to the Bonneville Salt Flats in the USA to do a speed of 200 miles an hour. I didn't quite get there. Did a speed of 189 miles an hour. Learned a lot. Building a new car. Go back 2012 to do a speed of 221 miles an hour for a world record. You know what? There's only one person in this room here today that can make that happen. And that's me. We are in a world, we accept no and we accept can't. This is a choice. You have a choice of your attitude, you have a choice of what you believe. As I say, I travel around the world. Look, when I flew over here, I flew business class. Like, we all fly business class when we fly overseas, right? Huh? Business class? What's the selling point of business class? Leg room. I'm trying to sublease. get a whole family down here, just sort of put them in the front. I was in Washington, D.C. last year. I went to the Smithsonian Institute for Aviation. Aviation is a passion of mine. Three of us in our group, we did a tour of the Smithsonian. Absolutely fantastic. On the way out, we were an hour early for our bus back to the hotel. A little bit of jet lag. Beautifully manicured lawns, a couple of palm trees. I jumped out of my chair. I took my cap off and fell asleep. And do you know, I woke 45 minutes later with $15 in my hat. I thought, only in America, oh, I love this place. Everywhere I went after that, I'd just sort of fall out of my chair, take my hat off, and I'd always get a couple of bucks. You see, that's people's perception. See how they judge me? I was also in the casino in Melbourne not that long ago with a group of friends. Now, they all went off to the bathroom. So I'm sitting outside waiting patiently, took my cap off again sitting there, and a Japanese couple came up and put $10 in my hat. True story, I'm thinking, this is great. But I wheeled up to them to give it back, and they started running. Maybe they thought it wasn't enough. I don't know. People's perception. I've got one of those four-wheeled race bikes, you know, quad sport racing bikes. Unbelievable things. I just have trouble staying on the seat. My friends reckon they're going to stick Velcro to my pants. And we were on a trail ride not that long ago in New Zealand, in the mud, and sliding through the forest, having such a great time, sliding my bike around the corner, eight of us in our group. We came around this corner, and there was a bog hole in front of us. Look, it was like half the size of this room, trees down either side, no way past. But me being the brave guy that I am, I looked back to my mates. I said, don't worry about it, guys, I'll go through it first. I hit the bog at great speed, the bike stopped, and off you go, straight out over the handlebars into the mud. But you see, it wasn't that deep. It was only up to here, me. And I got my gum boots on, you know, the yellow plastic PVC pants, right, with the ends on up. So I got my gum boots on, sitting in the mud, and these so-called mates having a great laugh at my expense. I said, come on, you guys, stop mucking around. Help me push the bike out, will you? They started to push the bike out. And as they were doing so, another group of riders came around the corner. And it was a race between our two groups. But in the spirit of fair play, we said, look, guys, come around here, you get away, no problem at all. They didn't listen to us. They rode their bike straight into the ditch on the side, just the back wheel sticking out of the mud. We said, you wallies, what did you do that for? We're telling you to come around this path here. They looked at us all as serious as could be. Said, you buggers are having us on. Look how deep it is where he is. I sort of went like out of the mud and I sat on the side, the look on their faces. We hopped on the bike, took off, come back an hour later, and they're still going, I can't believe this. Guys, the moral of the story is, all is not what it seems in this world, and sometimes opportunities aren't always where we expect them to be. Over the time of this four-day seminar, you will be given information and opportunities. The reality is that that's all it ever stays until you do something about it. Because we are in a world where it's so easy to blame other people for the challenges rather than go out, accept, create those challenges and simply be the best. I'm just going to finish off today. I've got 1 minute left, Joel. Oh, he's telling me to get off the stage. Hey, nice guy. That's what he's like, though. I've got another short piece of video I want to show you, just showing you some of the other things I enjoy doing in my life. You'll see New Zealand, where I live, my playground, the things that I enjoy. And if you just listen to the words of the song. So if you please, again, watch the screen.
Do you see what I see? A rainbow shining over us in the middle of a hopeless storm. Oh, sometimes I'm blinded by my feelings and I can see beyond my troubled mind, afraid of what I'll find. The story of our lives, but there's
time.
$6,000 on the clock, maybe 190, I hope. There was heaps better. I don't think I took a breath for 2 miles.
Tony, if there was one message you could leave people with, what would it be?
Don't let people take your dreams away. Just believe that success is going to come to us, because one of the challenges we face in our life is simply the belief in success.
Does breed success. You hang around with successful people, and that's what will happen to you. By being here at this seminar is a damn good start, because you hang around with successful people, and that's what will happen to you. I do believe in success. I do believe that I have the choices. I can be anything I want to be. I just have to want to do it badly enough. You know, all of those things. I guarantee if I went into your offices or your briefcases, but you've all seen them, those little booklets of inspiration, success breeds success. It's not what I drive, it's what drives me. You only get out of it what you put into it. If it's to be, it's up to me. It's not what happens to you, it's what you do about it that makes a difference. You know what, they're all true. Each and every one of those sayings are true. All you have to do is believe it. I want to share with you my final thought today. And it's, I think, one I've lived my life by. And it was from the great Henry Ford. He once said, if you think you can, you will. Think you can't, you won't. But hey, either way, you're probably right. Thanks so much for your time.
Put your hands together for this great man, an inspiration, a beacon of hope. What an outstanding individual. On behalf of all of us, we want to thank you for that enlightening presentation. You're a truly remarkable individual. Tony's going to be up here, so we're going to have a 15-minute out-of-room break. So before you leave the room, if you want to come up and say hello, Tony also has some books, and he also had some home studies out there in the foyer. Great reading. I actually flipped through it earlier and had a read of them. Go and see him. Check out his materials. Anything this man has to say will definitely enlighten your life. So actually, Tony's going to come outside, so you can come outside and you can say hello to him.
I don't know how to get down.
Well, I saw you get up there, so I know you know how to get down. Okay, so let's give one more hand, please. One more hand. Thank you.